all of you to our key symposium discussion today. We're going to be examining mental illness and the role that Chinese medicine can play in regards to a population that obviously is, relatively speaking, underserved by alternative medicine. You very often hear people talking about mental illness, but never really within the scope of it being treated by other domains of alternative medicine like homeopathy, and including in that Chinese medicine. So that's really the goal of our discussion today. Obviously, within the rich history of Chinese medicine, we have people that suffer from mental illness. And we know that the term mental illness within Chinese medicine is quite elusive because there's a fine line to say that someone has a mental situation as compared to what we would think of as a relatively normal situation in life. We also know that in Chinese medicine, it was very rare that we would even do a disparity between the body and the mind. That is to say that everything that a person experiences mentally can be also seen within the somatic aspect, within the bodily aspect of what that individual essentially is conveying in his or her life. So we know that if we were to just look at some of the surveys that we can see, at least within the U.S. population, we can say that statistically speaking, about one-fifth of the population suffers from mental illness, 18%. Right, of the population in the United States is said to suffer from mental illness. And so we're looking at really a very broad spectrum by which I believe Chinese medicine can make a very strong contribution to. Now granted, there might still be some legalities, right? I don't know what the laws are in the state of California. Right? There might be even concerns that an acupuncturist is treating, let's say, bipolar disorder, or treating depression, or treating schizophrenia for that matter. Right? And as a result, you very often will not find within the curriculums of a lot of acupuncture programs addressing this particular concern and this particular need. And while very traditionally, right, when we look at Chinese medical curriculums, very often you find that when dealing with what we would like to refer to as Shen disturbance, which is not a term that's even common in Chinese medical jargon per se. It's just really a term that we use in the West per se to say that someone has Shen disturbances. But rather, we very often in Chinese medicine will look at potentially symptoms such as depression. We might be looking at confusion or disorientation. Or we might be looking at things that involve some type of dissociative, right, associations in terms of person who basically becomes depersonalized. They don't really see themselves as having any validity in life. Or we might see that there is indeed memory loss. These are the types of symptoms that we might basically read about in Chinese medical jargon. And of course, there are certain conditions that we do know can be equated with mental illness, such as dianpang, mania, and withdrawal would be the English translation of that terminology, which we know appears already back in the textbook of the Neijing, be it reading in Su Wen or be it reading in the Lin Shi. So what we want to do is really get a clearer understanding of these symptoms, as well as these conditions, and be able to, in some ways, as I would argue, contribute to Western medicine and their understanding of some of these particular conditions. For example, we know that when we think of mental illness and we think of the idea of Shen, you cannot really see the Shen as inseparable from the Jin. In fact, we often use those two terms, right, collectively. Right? We often talk about Jin Shen. So that we often will see that during certain cycles of 7 and 8, when the Jing undergoes changes, that they can emerge during those particular changes certain type of Shen disturbances. For example, we know that personality disorders, right, or even schizophrenia very often occurs during adolescence, right? That's the most common population group that develops schizophrenia, and during early a doctorate. That means during the second and third cycle of 7 and 8 is where we see these particular conditions emerge. It's almost like the Jain kept it in a certain, kept the Shandavas in a certain stable state. And then after the person reaches maturity in terms of puberty, that particular Shen is given the opportunity to be, in some cases, lost. And that, namely, the idea that it's no longer confined to who you are. You begin to change radically who you are in terms of your nature, which we said is contained in the Jain, in terms of your personality. So we'll examine some of these ideas of personality disorders, which would be rooted in potentially some type of abnormal change in the essence. And for those of us who practice acupuncture, we know that if you're thinking of essence, we generally think of the eight extraordinary vessels, right? These are the channels that deals with the constitutional level. So as I'm suggesting to you, we actually have a lot of tools that we can have within our own, right, medicine that can be very effective in dealing with mental illnesses per se. You're going to find I'm not going to focus as much on herbal medicine because I think herbal medicine, in the way it's taught today, is very much based a lot on Western medicine. And that is to say that while we can study herbs historically and get a general sense of the ideas that were used in herbal medicine, that still is predicated on very similar understandings that we have in Western medicine. That is, if someone has these manic episodes, what we do is we give them things that essentially are considered very heavy, right? So usually we use minerals, and granted minerals do have a very important role because of their density and heaviness, they're not necessarily going to help the individual to resolve their mental condition. So things like lithium that we see from mania sometimes, right? Or we might see in Chinese medicine the use of things like oyster shell, right, the wumi, the dragon bones, the longwu, right, and sometimes maybe even potentially we see from a historical perspective the use of heavy metals, like the use of magnetite, right, or the use of hematite, right. So these are definitely might associate with their grounding effect, but obviously it's not attempting to really treat the shin disturbance itself per se. So we want to kind of like go beyond the idea of just using tranquilizers, using sedatives, using narcotics, right, and even antipsychotic drugs, because they basically, right, are like the idea of inducing latency of the Shen so that we don't see these disturbances of the Shen. Some of you were probably in our pre-symposium lecture last year where we talked about cancer. And we talked about in cancer that a lot of times the treatments basically involves latency. That is, again, you're not really treating the condition. What you're trying to do is prevent the condition from getting any worse, and you're trying to make the condition maintain a certain degree of dormancy so that you can be relatively functional in life. And that's what a lot of times medications does. We all know that if you go and visit a mental institution, that it's a relatively very peaceful environment. It's not the type of situations that you're going to see in motion picture. Most of the people you see are very subdued because they're on medication. Now, if that person was to leave that mental institution, maybe they went before a panel and it's deemed that this person's condition is stable, and that person goes back into the public, and that individual begins to stop their medication, as very often they do. As you know, in a matter of time, they eventually wind up coming back into the mental institution. Those are the populations that we want to help. Those are the people that we want to might be able to help wean them off their Western meds, and to be able to provide them with not, right, the idea of just inducing latency, as we'll see with a lot of herbal formulas, right, to nourish the blood and calm the Shen. These type of formulas, while they can give us a sense of tranquility, because it nourishes the blood, it stagnates the blood, and that's why even we look at one of the earliest herbal formulas, right, that we think of in dealing with Shen disturbances, like the Shen Zhou Ren Tong that we see from the Shanghu tradition. We see in the Shang, the Shenzhou Ren Tang, the use of the Shenzhou Ren sour by Juju Mi, by which nourishes the blood, as we've learned in modern Chinese medicine, and it calms the Shen. We know that in that formula, they also are responsible for invigorating the blood. You don't want the blood to just stagnate, right? And that's why you have in that formula like Gusticum Lucky Chi, the Chuan Gong, right? Because to keep the blood moving is to keep the Shen from not becoming stagnant, which along with the blood, right, begins to no longer allow us to fulfill what it is intended in our destiny or intended in our life. So even in that formula, it suggests to us that you can never nourish the blood without invigorating, on that particular case, moving the blood. Granted, it also has all the verbs in that formula, like the zimu, the amarena, that's in that formula, the fuling, right, and of course with the harmonizer, the licorice, the gansha. And then in a way, it sets the, what I would call the strategy that often you see in herbal formulas. In fact, one of the criteria that we might say, at least in judgment of a formula that is intended to deal with a sedating effect, a calming effect, would be, does it satisfy the criteria or the treatment principles established by the Shenzhou Ren Tang? Does the formula have herbs that nourishes the blood and calms the Shen? Right, and again, we place that with a number of herbs. Right? We have the viola seeds, right, or the fu xiao mai, right, the trichticum. Right, so we can have the baji ren, the viola seeds. We have trichticum. These are among some of our popular herbs that we see, and we see the number of formulas. What they really have done is just combine a bunch of them together. Right, so you have all three of those herbs, or you have two of those herbs, or something of that sort. And then thus the formula also has herbs that invigorates, moves, or maybe even dissipates the blood, depending on the severity of the blood stagnation, depending on the severity of what we might think of as the Shen disturbance, to use that term in explaining this mechanism. That is to say that in working with blood, you can either move the blood, which we know is under the domain of the lungs, right? Lung qi moves blood. So if the lungs is weak, certain herbs would not be really that effective in moving the blood, right? So examples like Gusticum Lucky Chi, Chuan Gong, right? Granted as spicy as warming, right? It's predicated on that this is an herb that basically relies on the lungs qi to move the blood, right? In other words, when you study herbal medicine, you might have come across these particular words and you might have thought that they were used interchangeably, and they're not, right? When you see words like sheng, sheng means to move, right? When you see the word he, right? This translates as to invigorate. On some acupuncture books, they use the word that it quickens the blood, right? So that's the word that they translate. And then you might even see the word san, or the word po. San essentially means to dissipate, and po means to break up the blood. So all of these are actions, right, that we do to the blood, and these actions require qi, if not yang, because blood as a yin commodity needs to be moved. You cannot just basically try to pacify the Shen, because the Shen, remember, is light. It needs to be moved. So it's not just about trying to sedate you so much that you go into a relatively catatonic state, into a state of stupor. But really, it's about helping you to be able to understand where that Shen has become stagnant, and to be able to find ways by which that Shen can become liberated. So, like Gusticum Lucky Chi, as an example, is an herb that moves the blood, right? So it doesn't have, and that movement requires lung qi, whereas if you wanted to invigorate the blood, that depends highly on hua qi. And hua qi, we know, is engendered by liver's blood. That means if you are deficient in the liver, which we know a lot of the pharmaceutical drugs will make the liver become stagnant and eventually become deficient, then the ability of finding solutions, right, is going to be difficult. And that's why we generally become dependent on these drugs for the rest of our lives. And so what you want to do is you want to be able to nourish your liver's blood, so it's able to engender Hua Qi, which will then invigorate the blood, and again allow the Shen some degree of resolution in one's life. And then to break up requires, right, a greater amount of intensity. We often think of breaking up in terms of hematomas, right, in terms of blood mass, right? We might see that indeed there is a brain trauma, a brain injury that's causing the individual to have memory loss. Or maybe we see that there is indeed a lot of plaque that is building up in the brain, as in the case of Alzheimer's, right? These protein plaques, right, which, by the way, protein is, you know, synthesized by the liver. Right? Liver, from a Chinese medical point of view, right, ends its trajectory internally at the brain. So we can see that maybe the liver indeed is having a lot of blood stagnation, which means that it's not able to really enrich the blood because the blood itself is stagnant in the liver, which means the Hua Qi cannot then invigorate the blood and move the blood, which means moving the Shen, and that blood stagnation begins to deposit into the brain, causing us to have these so-called lapses in memory. And so we want to be able to break that up. And so given, right, that the Hua Qi is deficient because of liver blood stasis, or maybe deficient liver blood, then we require the yang of the kidneys to break up, right, to dissipate the blood. And if someone has kidney yang deficiency, which unfortunately is innate in some ways associated with the aging population, that as we get older, our essence declines, right, as a part of the natural function of human life, then we're going to know that it's much more harder, unless we tonify the kidneys, to be able to break up the blood stagnation, right, that in the brain or anywhere else for that matter. So the idea here is that we cannot just nourish and give you comfort. We also want to help you to be able to find some type of resolution in your life, right? It's like if someone's crying, our general inclination is to give them a hug, to give them comfort. But we still, right, need to be able to help them, at least to help them, to help themselves, to be able to find some resolution for the distresses that they have in their life. So this is why it's very important that when you are just evaluating any formula whose intentions is to work on Qin disturbances, which again in more modern Chinese medicine is based more on Western medicine, which is the use of these like downers, we might call them, like these antidepressants, these drugs that is intended to reduce to some degree, right, the firing, right, or we might consider the so-called the postsynaptic, right, neurons, right, as they would like to describe it in Western medicine. So a lot of it is about essentially reducing, right, the stimulation of the nervous system. But that, right, would cause the body to become sluggish. And as it becomes sluggish, it might not exhibit any of these emotional outbreaks per se, or even these emotional disharmonies. But it does not allow us to necessarily find resolution in our lives. Okay? So this is an important principle that you have. In other words, what I'm suggesting to you is that if you were to look at the Shaolin tradition, and that's very often what I would recommend that you do, that is to look at the formulas and then try to understand what was potentially the strategy. In other words, formulas are not intended for you to memorize them and to use them the way they are. Now, that's just for learning purposes. Formulas are intended for you to understand that it's a strategy. Once you understand that strategy, then you create your own formulas as it's tailored to the individual that you're working with. And the Shen Zhouren Tong, in a way, gives us the strategy of what's involved when trying to calm, when trying to nourish the Shen. Right? So you have in those type of formulas, like herbs that's going to nourish blood because the Shen is contained in the blood by Chinese medical theory. But at the same time, like, it has to exert a calming effect on the Shen. It calms the Shen. Right? Not all herbs, right, by theory, Tom's a shen, even though they have a lot of herbs that nourish his blood, for example, right? So, for example, horseshoe wu, people would not necessarily say that calms the shen, even though it nourishes blood. Right? We say, wawamani, sheng di, right? You could say, oh, that nourishes blood, but, you know, usually say it calms the shen. You could say, white peony, bai sha, right? Nourishes the blood. But again, most people usually do not equate that with having an effect of calming the shen. So we do have all the herbs that we recognize seem to have much more of an immediate effect on the shen. Right? Herbs like shenzhou ren, sao jujube, or the baji ren, the biota seeds. Notice the interesting component is that these are seeds, whereas previously most of the herbs I mentioned were roots, right? Be it horseshoe wu, right? Or be it the shengdi, or be it the baisha. Those are all roots that I mentioned. Right? So seeds seem to have an impact on the shen, because as we know, as a law of signature, seeds affects the chain. Right? So we could have really researched more seeds for that matter and try to get a general sense of other seeds seems to exert this calming effect, even though in most cases, as we know, a lot of times seeds generally are more warming than cooling per se. Right? That's why these will be interesting components. And so we have this first principle. And then the second principle that we have is that, you know, the theory of shenhua, right? The theory of engender and transform, right? It's a theory that is used a lot in gynecology, right? The notion that you can never nourish his blood without, right, transforming or moving, invigorating, dissipating the blood, right? So this notion is very important, because if someone has blood stasis, it deprives other areas of having blood. So it means to break up the blood, you also need to nourish the areas that's been deprived of blood. And if you have blood deficiency, what is the body's innate tendency? Well, the body is going to try to accumulate blood, given that I have blood deficiency. It might not accumulate it in a much more harmonious way, in the sense that that blood that we're accumulating for the blood deficiency may become stagnant. So as a result, we have blood stasis. So a very important principle in gynecology is that whatever you do for blood, you always need to move the blood or invigorate the blood. Right? That's usually characterized by Dong Wei, right? Angelicus sinensis. It's an herb that you know that not only nourishes blood, but innate in that herb is that it also invigorates, right, the blood. So that's why, right, it tells you already that you have to do both. And that's what we said, that you have to either move, right, invigorate, right, or dissipate the blood. And how we determine what strategy we need to use is depends on the individual, right? If my lungs are strong, then herbs that moves the blood is going to be appropriate. But if my lungs are weak, it doesn't make sense to stress my lungs even more, right, and give them herbs that has the ability of moving blood, okay? So we might then look at the invigorating blood. Well, I can't invigorate blood if I have liver blood deficiency. So I might need to nourish not only blood to calm the shen, but also may need to nourish blood, right, in particular relating to the liver. Right? And then I'll add herbs, right, that will help the liver as it nourishes blood and make sure the liver doesn't become stagnant in blood. That's why you're still, right, moving the blood, so that it will engender hot qi. And then in that context, you will be able to invigorate blood. And the same thing would go if the kidneys are weak, then we cannot break up the blood. And you can't break up the blood unless you tonify the kidneys. And sometimes that might be your intention, because you know that the blood stasis is, right, either very acute, but very, very severe, as in the case of a brain trauma, or that this blood stasis is very chronic. It's been building up for a very long time. Right? The plaque has been building up for a very long time. The cholesterol has been building up for a very long time. The arteriosclerosis. And the history of the individual, right, of having a number of heart surgeries, right, indicates that there is this process by which blood is building up, and that blood has not been able to be dissipated because the person's yang is deficient. So we have to build their kidney yang so that we're able to break up the plaque that's building up, be it in the arteries or be it in the brain itself. And so that requires then herbs that's going to tonify kidney yang, or herbs that warms the interior to expect to basically give it a cold, to expel cold, and in the process of building back the kidneys. So that's another part of our strategy. And then of course the we have to, by its formulation, strengthen the spleen, right? You might say. Or you might say strengthen the knee, the mind. Right? That would be another part. Because as we know, one of the aspects of Chinese medicine is that Chinese medicine essentially believes that the way that you resolve a lot of your mental issues is by the mental faculty of thought. Right? That is, that you have to really look at the relationship to the spleen and its management of blood. Its management of blood is its management of the Shen. So all Shen disturbances can be seen as an inappropriate or mismanagement of one's mind, one's right, mental faculties that we associate with the yin. So we need to strengthen that. And we also need to might be concerned that as you try to get nourishment, as we all know, meaning someone gives you comfort, right, and that nourishment that they give you can sometimes make you become too dependent, right, on that nourishing quality. Right? That's what we do. We also become dependent on drugs. Right? And then we essentially need more of it. Right? We reach a point of tolerance, and then we need higher amounts of that particular drug. Just like someone gave you a hug and that felt good. And you wish that person would give you more hugs. And it's the same thing. When we become clingy, we become very needy. And as a result, it means that we lose our own capacity to empower ourselves. You might think of that as the will, as some later generations would associate that with, especially in the Tang Dynasty. Well, it's your will that's weak. You don't have good willpower to become self-motivated. You need others. In which case, then you focus more on the kidney's will, the herbs like the polygala, the Yuan Zhi, that is very popular during the Tang Dynasty, especially with Sun Simao of the Tang Dynasty. But if we go back to the Han Dynasty, we would say it's more about the mind. It's more about the spleen, and we would use organ energetics to explain this. Right? And it's about how we are able to make sure that as we nourish the person, that we don't get clingy. And clinginess, right, is wanting something right, where you can't really right, have the fortitude to get rid of it. And that becomes dampness. Right? That's why they use things like Fu Ling. And as we know, we fine-tune Fu Ling to Fu Shen, so that we're able to get rid of dampness. Right? And at the same time, right, strengthen the spleen, the mind, and the mind's ability to resolve the emotions that might be causing the so-called Shen disturbances, per se. And that's the role of Fu Ling and the Shen Zhou Ren Tong. Right? Not only does it strengthen the spleen, right, but it also, as we know, deals with dampness, per se. And then, of course, we might say, well, if you think of this consideration of Shen disturbances, you can say that it might be caused by heat. Others might say it's caused by cold. Right? But generally, we think of it as, according to the Ling Shu, right, they talk about this idea of Dian Kong. They say it begins in Yang Ming. It begins in the stomach. See? No, once again, the stomach and spleen, the birth faculties, right, the mind. Right? It is about inappropriate thoughts, right, or the inability to create thoughts to control inappropriate emotions. So it begins in Yang Ming, so we need to clear heat. And that's in Yang Ming. Right? As we know, the major herb that clears heat in Yang Ming, at least in the Shaolin tradition, besides using minerals like gypsum, Shi Gao, as in the Bai Fu Tong, it's an associate, which is Zimu Anna Morana. Right, so this is that herb that's in the formula. Of course, we can say, well, it also nourishes fluids, but helps to nurture yin. And that would support the idea of helping a person to have a better sense of who they are, who you nourish your yin. But we can also say that it's used primarily